Let's begin. This is the June 22nd, 2023 joint conceptual workshop between the Planning Commission and Alderman. And we'll begin with a roll call. Commissioner Allen.
Present.
Commissioner Franks.
Present.
Commissioner Harrison is not here. Commissioner Lindsay is also absent. Commissioner McLemore.
Present.
Commissioner Mann is absent currently. Commissioner Orr is here. Alderman Peterson.
Here.
Alderman Williamson.
Present.
Oh, Commissioner Williamson. Sorry about that. Promotion there. Alderman Berger. Alderman Brown. Absent. Alderman Potts.
Present.
Alderman Baggett. Absent. Alderman Barnhill. Absent. Alderman Blanton. Absent. Alderman Hansen.
Present.
Mayor Moore.
Yes, sir.
All right. Accommodations have been made to ensure that the public is able to view the meeting. The public may view the workshop in the following ways. Watch the meeting on Franklin TV or City of Franklin website. Watch the live stream through the City of Franklin Facebook and YouTube accounts. Attend in person in the boardroom. The public may also watch the meeting on the TV in the lobby. All right. Item one. This is a discussion of the development plan proposing one duplex with one modification of standards and its parking. This is located at 611 Mount Hope Street. Staff?
Yes. The current site has a house on it, and it formerly had a trailer on it. The goal of Hard Bargain is to build a duplex here, but the zoning doesn't allow it. So they're looking to do a rezoning. There's a couple options on how they could proceed forward, but the PD district gave them the most flexibility. It allowed BOMA and Planning Commission to see the actual plan being proposed versus just a straight rezoning. It also allows them to ask for relief for the parking requirements. They're going to ask for an MOS essentially to do 5 parking spaces instead of the required 6. That would include 3 on site and 2 on-street parking spaces that exist today. Staff supports it and is working with Hard Bargain to move it through the process accordingly.
All right. To have an applicant.
I'm Sydney Hall representing Hard Bargain with Civil and Environmental Consultants, and then this is Derek with Hard Bargain. I feel like Amy really touched base on most of it, but I'm here to answer any questions that you guys might have.
Okay. Comments? Anyone? Will you bring it up on the screen and just show us what you're talking about?
For sure. So this is the project area right here. Like Amy said, is one property owned by Hard Bargain Association. It's located at the corner of Mount Hope Street and 9th Avenue North. There is an existing residence there that will be demolished and replaced. It's a historic African-American neighborhood, and then there's potential for continued growth of affordable housing. These are just some of the community meeting notes, some of the issues that some of the neighbors had concerns with, and a lot of that was just really maintaining the character of the existing neighborhood. They were concerned about investors buying and potential for renting it, and they weren't wanting that. But Derek was able to kind of confirm that in their bylaws, there's no renting allowed, things like that. Let's see what else there was. There were some concerns about the parking, just if people can store their vehicles or trailers indefinitely on any of the spaces. And it was explained that the public spaces were subject to the same regulations as all public spaces in the City of Franklin. They were asking about any additional notices that would be sent out, and there will be. And then they were receptive to the development, but were concerned about the project would be to help beautify the entrance of the neighborhood. This is currently the existing site. So again, one existing residence fronting onto Mount Hope Street. It is the adjacent vacant portion is right next to the right. There is on-street parking on Mount Hope Street. that is on the north side of the street. There is limited parking on site, and there is an existing retaining wall that borders the vacant portion on north and east frontages. So this is our proposed site plan. There's proposed driveway access off of Mount Hope Street, and then there would be one two-story duplex that would be fronting Mount Hope Street. Each of those units would be a three-bedroom, one-and-a-half-bath residence. It'd be an addition of three off-street parking spaces. Really two, I'm not sure why it says three, but and then we'd be maintaining and utilizing two existing on-street. I messed that up. We're having three off-street, so it'd be on the property and then two on the street, sorry. The benefits of the development is an addition of two new high-quality, affordable residences in a historical community, improved parking available to residents with the addition of three parking spaces, beautification of the existing neighborhood, minimal impact to public services or traffic volumes, stormwater improvements that will be consistent with city standards, and conformance with Envision Franklin.
Okay.
So what is the price point? And it's going to be for sale, did you say?
Yes, ma'am. For the record, I'm executive director for Hard Bargain Association. My name is Derek L. Solomon. To answer your question, yes, the price point will actually be lower than the $590,000, which is our median household sale for a median income family. We're looking at right approximately about $288,000. We do have to raise some funds, so one of our fundraisers, which is this weekend, the Blackberry Jam, which is our 20th, that's what we'll be doing. We'll actually be helping the Blackberry Jam committee raise funds to basically bridge the gap. One side of the home, so far we have one qualified candidate with a Franklin Special School District educator who's local. So we're trying to keep her local. She's currently right now lives in Spring Hill and wants to not have a 40-hour commute a month. And we also have a sanitation engineer for Williamson County. That's a long-time Franklinite, and he wants to be closer to home as well. So both the projects will be going to local families, low to moderate income families.
So just based on the parking needs you normally see in that area, no concern about being minus one spot?
No, sir. It's typically a smaller, well-niched, two-square city block community, and we always work amongst ourselves as far as that. And the families that we're about to afford the opportunity to purchase this home, they also have small families, so it's not a large family. Plus, anytime we needed a bigger function, they could always use my office or Ty's house for additional uses of parking. We work with Head Springs Depot and even the school up the street with Johnson. So anytime we needed, like for the cleanup, for example, we had over 100 volunteers out. So we always work with the parking. But for us, just the home itself particularly, then, yeah, the fire space should suffice.
Okay. Any additional questions?
How has staff looked at this? What is staff doing with this?
Yeah, we've worked with Derek even before he submitted it, and in general, you know,
yes,
it's looking like it's meeting all the zoning ordinance regulations.
It's beautiful, actually.
Anyone else? All good? All right. Thank you. Appreciate it. Item 2, discussion of development plan revision proposing a changing height of the multifamily buildings and the removal of an external access point within the eastern portion of the plan located at the intersection of MacArthur Parkway and New Highway 96. And this is the West Haven PUD Revision 6. Staff.
Thank you. Revision 6 does propose an increase in the height allowance to 5 stories for the proposed independent living facility to align with the West Haven pattern book and to remove the road from the West Haven Jewel area to New Highway 96 West. These are the only proposed changes, and staff has no concerns of note at this time.
Okay. Thank you. Applicant?
Ben Crenshaw with Southern Land Company. I really don't have anything to add, but here to answer any questions.
Okay. Do you have any questions from?
No, no questions really, but it's making everything in a different, you know, kind of going around and kind of putting three buildings kind of work, you know, fronting on a lawn or something like that. I don't know exactly how to say that.
Yeah, but, I don't know who, are you controlling this?
Yeah, it's not working.
Okay.
Okay.
But I can scroll down.
Okay, if you can. The bottom line is that we want this area to be like the rest of West Haven. And when we went through the concept plan revision back in 2020, it was really a placeholder for the independent living. It was sort of a generic footprint. And after we really got serious about developing this area, we took a really hard look at the design and the circulation, and we felt like it wasn't up to the rest of West Haven standards. And so that's really the impetus for the change. But yes, creating a much more interesting environment that's surrounding a public green space that really encourages much more walkability and connection over to the rest of the West Haven Town Center.
See. Anyone else? Comments, thoughts? None? All right. Thank you.
That's going to show the road layout question. There.
Okay.
Yeah. If you would, just as far as height goes, mm-hmm. how does this compare to the other structures? And I apologize, this is not pulling up as fast as I'd like. Mm-hmm.
So, Chelsea, I think the best one is if we can show the two comparing the one site plan right next to the other site plan. So right now, as Chelsea explained, in the pattern book, which governs a lot of our bulk regulations within West Haven, we're allowed to go five stories. So mm-hmm. from a zoning perspective, it's within sort of our envelope. Mm-hmm. Our tallest building right now is four stories.
Thank you.
So going along Front Street in our town center, that's our tallest building. We will have several other four-story buildings that will be coming in soon to staff over on the other side of Mac Hatcher. But we feel like because of this is set back from 96, set back from Mac Hatcher, that the scale of the space really is able to receive that height, and it'll look really as a good addition to the rest of West Haven.
Sure. All right.
And actually, it's number 11 is the one that I printed it out myself.
So you can see that arrangement is much more kind of in keeping with the spirit of what we're doing at West Haven. Yeah. There you go.
And the street change is a better thing too, right?
And we've been in discussions with staff. We had a connection out to Highway 96 in our original concept plan. In our traffic study, it carried very little traffic. And you can see all of the shaded area is either wetland or buffer.
Right, exactly.
And to go through the heartache to try to make that connection for very little benefit from our perspective is just not worth it. And I think staff agrees. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Anyone else have comments on this one?
I guess my only question, again, none of my stuff is loading here, is for the road that goes out to, I think it's Downs Boulevard out there. Is there any improvement of anything on the intersection for the additional road? I know that turn lane gets a little hairy sometimes.
So we, as even part of our concept plan revision 5 that we mm-hmm. got approved previously, we have improvements that are about to start construction to Boyd Mill that extend okay. about, okay. oh, maybe 150 yards south of our connection to mm-hmm. Boyd Mill, all the way up to the intersection
okay.
At Highway 96. So that curve is really dangerous. If mm-hmm. those of us who drive it, that is a really dangerous curve right there. And so adding more traffic, it really warranted we're smoothing out the curve, taking the vertical curve down a little bit mm-hmm. and making some improvements. And having a pedestrian connection all the way out to the corner now, which allows us to get across the Mac Hatcher.
Yeah, to connect to that.
Yeah, multimodal. Well.
Okay, great.
And the other thing is, really, the other side to this is going to be Mac Hatcher.
That's correct. Mac Hatcher is just on the left hand side here.
Exactly.
Okay. Last call. None?
All right. Thank you, everyone.
Appreciate it. All right, our next item is a presentation and discussion of the Goose Creek Coordinated Study Update. Staff?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and good evening, aldermen and planning commissioners. I'm going to try and cover five topics quickly. The purpose, which is to present a fourth land use scenario to be integrated into the envisioned Franklin comprehensive update, and then also talk about the previous land use scenarios. There are three, and present the fourth, and discuss the draft special considerations and talk about the next steps. So the three previous land use scenarios, scenario one shows, we call it the flyover concept. It shows a southern flyover over I-65 that's south of Ramsey Solutions. So it does have some connectivity. And then scenario two is the partial interchange scenario. And that shows a potential partial interchange that's south of Ramsey Solutions on Pratt Lane. And scenario three shows limited connectivity. It doesn't show a connection to I-65 or the flyover. It removes that altogether and is more reflective of kind of the short and midterm growth capabilities of this basin. So the fourth scenario, it focuses on the short and midterm, but it also plans for the entire basin. So it kind of merges the flyover concept and the limited connectivity concept into this fourth scenario. It heavily utilizes conservation subdivision, which is being refined as part of the comprehensive update to envision Franklin. Right now, we have the one conservation subdivision, and we're looking at creating potentially three new design concepts out of that one. So that's being worked on internally and with the consultant. It also utilizes single family residential as a transitional design concept between the conservation subdivision and the higher intensity uses of neighborhood mixed use and mixed residential. And the staff also anticipates changes to neighborhood mixed use, which is used in this area to better define multifamily. The northwest part of the study area is considered by our staff to be a shorter term growth area. That's where we anticipate, or at least would like to see growth to occur first. So Carruthers Parkway can be extended and Goose Creek Bypass can be extended. So development should be limited in the southern kind of third of the study area until the street network to the north and the southern flyover can at least be, there's at least a timeline for that to occur. So some of the other projects, you know, I mentioned the Goose Creek Bypass extension, the Carruthers extension, improvements to the Paytonsville and Pratt intersection, and then also building out Reams Fleming Boulevard. It doesn't go all the way through yet. So those are some projects that need to be completed probably before the longer term areas can really build out. In terms of special considerations, we've got some draft ones for a couple of these design concepts. So I'll start with regional commerce, which is the area in dark purple. And location one, which is south of Long Lane, it's roughly where the Refuge Center has been approved for their plan. And the special consideration reads that future development should be low scale, non-residential uses with minimal to moderate traffic demands that are compatible with adjacent approved projects. Institutional uses are encouraged. So what we're saying is we want uses with low to moderate traffic demands that are lower scale and that are kind of compatible and contextual to the Refuge Center and then like the previously approved Montessori School. Location two, which is south of the future Goose Creek Bypass extension. Support uses with relatively low traffic impacts like institutional, small scale office, local commercial, and other residential uses, not just large scale multifamily. So based on the traffic study and the traffic modeling that we had conducted earlier in the process, having another large scale regional headquarters right there was gonna be problematic with the I-65 and Goose Creek interchange. So we're looking for uses that are gonna be, that maybe can like supplement some of the projects that are going in, some of the approvals going in, and not exacerbate the peak hour delays that we're anticipating if everything builds out. The third special consideration for regional commerce would be for the property south of Ramsey Solutions along I-65. And it reads that development south of the Reams Fleming Tract will heavily depend upon the completion of Reams Fleming Boulevard, the Pratt Lane and Paytonsville Road intersection, as well as the timing of the proposed I-65 flyover and the Carruthers Parkway extension from Long Lane to Lewisburg Pike. So from our conversations with engineering, they want to see these improvements done before large-scale development occurs south of Ramsey. For neighborhood mixed use, which is the lighter purple area, location one, which is roughly at the future Goose Creek Bypass and future Carruthers Parkway intersection, that one reads at least one quadrant of that intersection should have primarily local commercial uses anchoring the intersection to serve the area. And then location two applies more generally to the neighborhood mixed use areas. And that refers back to new standalone multifamily buildings should be small scale in order to create a low scale residential character as you travel away from I-65. So kind of going back to the discussion we had at the special joint meeting about trying to be a little more specific in our plans about multifamily and maybe allow for smaller scale multifamily and calling that out and better defining that. So we think that's appropriate for this area. And then the third area is down on Pratt Lane, south of Ramsey Solutions, and similar language that we used with the previous one in that area, and that's new development south of the Reams Fleming Tract will heavily depend upon the completion of Reams Fleming Boulevard, the Pratt Lane-Paytonsville intersection, as well as the timing of the proposed I-65 flyover and the Carruthers Parkway extension from Long Lane to Lewisburg Pike. And then two special considerations with regards to conservation subdivision. One being scenic corridor overlay should be applied for properties along Paytonsville, which basically calls out a deep setback and some plantings, canopy trees, special types of fencing perhaps. And that's just to kind of preserve the rural character. And then location two, Pratt Lane and potential flyover. And again, it reads very similar to those other three along Pratt Lane, and that's new development south of the Reams Fleming Tract will heavily depend upon the completion of Reams Fleming Boulevard, Pratt Lane and Paytonsville Road intersection, as well as the timing of the proposed I-65 flyover and the Carruthers Parkway extension from Long Lane to Lewisburg. We also note and understand that an I-65 interchange, a partial interchange, could have regional significance and may necessitate a reevaluation of the design concept and special considerations. We've had conversations with TDOT, but at this point, we have no reason to believe that that is a viable project at this point. I think the flyover concept is kind of what we're going with. If the interchange, if that starts to materialize, and we can pivot our policy guidance, but we don't really have reason to believe that the interchange is a viable option at this point. But if it does become viable, then we can pivot with our guidance. So in terms of next steps, as part of the comprehensive Envision Franklin update, the Goose Creek study, the UGB, they're all starting to merge together. The UGB and the Envision Franklin update are essentially tracking together along a very similar adoption timeline. So for the overall Envision Franklin update, we'd like to assign design concepts for the entire study area, including the conservation design concept, and then include the special considerations. And, you know, the special considerations shown tonight are kind of a big picture of what we're thinking. So thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Questions, comments?
But this obviously is not for this side here, but you know, aren't they talking about the new In-N-Out Burger going to be on Goose Creek?
But yes, ma'am.
It's going to be on the what, west side?
Yes, ma'am.
Uh-huh. But I wondered where and how that might affect some of this. I haven't seen any map that shows where they're thinking about, but they're saying they're purchasing the land.
Across from McDonald's down there. On paper. Chick-fil-A, McDonald's.
Oh, okay.
It's right across the road. We've looked at that property before and talked about it in relationship to the subdivision that it backs up to, but that's the property. I think it's 25 acres.
Well, that would be a part of this very first. I mean, when I'm looking at scenario four, wouldn't that be on there?
It's on the, it's further west.
Okay.
Other side of the interstate.
Okay, it's right here. 840.
And the existing zoning for that property was factored into the traffic study anyway, so that was accounted for.
Anyone else?
I mean, I think four, I guess, is better than one, two, and three, but the what I was, you know, we don't see traffic counts, we don't see transportation infrastructure investment on this in this model, and I know that we've kind of exceeded the, I guess, probably consultant hours to get that done, but the math wasn't looking good on 1, 2, and 3 for transportation, and so it's hard, you know, so now we're asked to endorse a fourth scenario without knowing the transportation cost, and then start, you know, give people the green light. I know that there's a short, mid, and long term here, but it's better than 1, 2, and 3, but I just still have a ton of concerns on the costs to taxpayers that exceed the road impact fees that we'll collect from development. You know, I think we've talked about different financing options, TIFs and this and that to do more over here, which, you know, it's hard for me to say, oh yeah, go ahead and apply these development types to this area when to not know the cost impacts of the traffic, because I mean, if we were looking at $100 million in roads after impact fees on one of the last scenarios, I mean, it's just a big number, and I think we'd be wise to consider that. Now, does that mean we need to hold up the entire vision framework process? No, probably not. But I think we don't also need to rush into it, to applying some overlays just because we're in the middle of the, without knowing those transportation costs. I'd rather look at this area with all of that information in hand than, I mean, I don't think this is too far off, but I still don't know what the cost of the roads are going to be. All the citizens that live here already that, you know, are going to have to pay for that, those roads.
Well, if I may, in the current CIP, I believe, Jimmy, correct me if I'm wrong, there, we've programmed the Paytonsville Pratt Lane intersection improvement, the Long Lane overpass.
Mm-hmm. How much is it going to be? You know, after I hadn't looked at it, I didn't go back and look at it.
Which project, the Paytonsville?
No, I'm talking about just the Long Lane overpass, period.
Oh, it's, well, that one's already been funded. I don't have that number off the top of my head.
Well, we hadn't spent it, though. It's
right.
Andrew, will you finish that?
Yeah, so I guess my point is there's one other minor improvement, I believe, to Pratt Lane, like a bridge culvert.
Yeah, the bridge is, I believe that bid's gone out and been awarded at this point.
Okay, so there are three projects that the city has committed to fund. That's it. So,
well, I know, and that's the point, is that there were, and that was included in that financial analysis the last time, was the CIP funds already committed, and there was still a nine figure.
Yeah.
And that was, and then also there was the traffic, the impact fees were calculated into that as well. Mm-hmm. So it makes me nervous, but those, mm-hmm, I'll let others.
The Spine Road, I think, is the responsibility of Boyle, and if I'm not mistaken.
It is. It's a local roadway. Their responsibility for, as development occurs.
I mean,
we see that.
We've annexed it. We made a step toward, I mean, this is where housing's going to be in our community. we have to continue to work forward toward it. I just wish it was cheaper. I'm like Patrick, but
I think we pretty much, I mean, if we're honest with ourselves, and I understand exactly what Alderman Haggett's saying, but I think we pretty much have eliminated, if we're honest with ourselves, we pretty much, through study and conversations and meetings, have almost eliminated the flyover concept, if we're honest with ourselves. We pretty much almost eliminate, well, okay, I won't say eliminate, but if we've gone through it, scenario one and two, we basically have said no, okay? Feasibility-wise, traffic-wise, when we looked at it, money-wise, okay? And although I'm with you on scenario four about as far as money and all that, but we got to get something in place in order to attach figures to. Otherwise, we're never going to know, okay? And so we're not to the end at all, right? But if we were looking at the four and throwing darts, or even just saying which one can we at least live with massaging, four is kind of where we are, because we have beat this thing almost to death, buried it, and brought it back again. And so I think scenario four is probably where we are. The money is going to be a killer on all of them. But four is probably the best we have right now. And we're still going to have to massage it. We're still going to have to look at it. But Lord, that flyover, God, one, two, and I won't even put, but one and two, three, and I think four is probably the best we have, and we're still going to have to look at it some more, most definitely, I think.
And the one thing about all those dollars for the improvements, it's not due all at once.
Right.
That's over a period of, what, 15,
yeah,
20 years, maybe.
Yeah.
And I don't think the flyover is dead either.
Well, not dead, and that's why I was hesitant to say, but we've...
I think the intersection may, the new intersection may be dead.
Yeah, but I think that's
but
dead.
But I think
so,
the flyover would...
Yeah.
You know, I would look for engineering for some comments with TDOT,
yeah,
but I think the flyover is something that we could convince them that we needed to do.
It was just in coordination with TDOT was kind of giving us a little heartburn and angst, and but yeah, so it's not dead, but it was kind of like, you know, we kind of had a more angst. Let's just say this.
Well, if we look at the failure rate of Paytonville and the current interchange there, we've got to do something.
Yeah, we've got to do something.
We've got to have some other road.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Let's just say more comfort with four. How about that? I'll kind of take back that.
TDOT has no issue with the flyover, and we would design it and set it up so that if someday in the future an interchange was entertained, it could be connected.
Wow.
So we'd be prepared for it, and certainly the flyover was no issue with TDOT because we're not touching the interstate
just
at that point.
Getting the funding and get it going. It's just every time
right.
I think about Matt Catcher, because, you know, we were discussing that Matt Catcher when I was sitting here in the, you know, 9180. That was just only that, more comfort with four. I'll just say it that way. That sounds so much better.
You were just 12.
Yeah, I was 12 years old, yeah.
I have a question. How is it that Spring Hill, and maybe Columbia also, but Spring Hill is getting a connection to the interstate every time you turn around?
Special dispensation from Senator Lamar Alexander.
The biggest concern for TDOT with this specific interchange is its proximity to 840.
Yeah.
So when you have two interstates connecting to each other, there's a distance that the Federal Highway Administration wants you to be away before you impact that with another connection, because there's so much traffic generated right there.
Mm-hmm. I think there's.
But
still
I had to say,
highway.
I just happened to have gone down, you know, again in Spring
sure
Hill and
the,
Columbia both.
I think within a year.
And it's
do.
Just amazing everything that they're building right out there. And as I say, it's not all that far from everything. I see what you mean about 840 now that I'm looking at the picture.
It's right
there.
Down the road.
But they've got all kinds of things just going off.
If you're familiar with driving through Metro Nashville, there's multiple interstates that interconnect right there, and multiple interchanges as well, and you can see how problematic that can get.
Mm-hmm.
So that's when TDOT looks at things like
mm-hmm.
this and says no, because it requires a potential redesign of 840's interchange as well. So it just becomes very costly, and they don't see the real benefit to the network.
Ladies first.
No, whichever.
I was just pointing to you.
Oh, thanks. Thanks, Mr. Chair. Just a couple of things. I want to thank staff for putting this together. I did have an opportunity to get some input from members of the Berry Farms HOA, as well as speak over at a high level with the Franklin Alliance Homeowner Association for Ward 3. And after we reviewed it, we're like-minded. Scenario number 4 appears to be the best option at this point. A couple of things. Do want to acknowledge a financial component of this. Mr. Chair, I think you pointed out, or someone else said, it's basically over 20 plus years at this point is what our financial commitment would be. I just wanted to see if we could go to slide number 8 for just a second. One of the things I want to just make sure that we're looking at, and I appreciate this, is we're looking at having the vision, and I do appreciate that on the second bullet point right there, we draw attention to not just large-scale multifamily uses. I think that's important for everybody to see and to hear right now that might be in that area. In addition, if you go to slide 9, one of the things that we've talked about, and I remember when I was campaigning and even being early in office, we talked about infrastructure. And I think it's good that we're having the vision right now to put the infrastructure in place now, as before we just build everything. I think that's extremely important. Slide 10, you guys, you referenced talking about having small scale on the second bullet point right there. Multifamily buildings should be small scale in order to create low scale residential character. I think in this area of town, that's gonna be really important as we start getting further away from the interstate. And then as you move down to just a couple more here on slide 12, something I really wanna point out here is the preservation of rural character is extremely important. I know when we met, last week, just recently, and we talked about the new conservation residential options, that we need to focus on that. I love the idea of having uniform fence design in that area to really give it that look and feel as well. And then lastly there on slide 13 is the fact that we are being proactive right now. And I think this is what a lot of residents want to hear, whether it's in Ward 3 or across Franklin, is that assigning design concepts to the areas and having that plan in addition to it, as opposed to just letting people come in and just build whatever they want to do right now. And the last piece right here is the assigning conservation areas. We're talking about preserving space as often as possible, and I think conservation is key right now.
Points. You mentioned an offset from the Paintsville Road as far as how building setbacks. Mm-hmm. What was that?
I referenced the scenic corridor overlay, which is a zoning overlay, and specific corridors are identified and what those setbacks should be. This would probably be like 150 feet off the right of way.
Okay. So similar to what we're doing at MacHatcher?
Similar to many others, yes, sir.
I would encourage you to look at 300 down this way, down past the single family, because of that rural character down there. And the other thing on this, you know, you got conservation subdivision down here. Well, the hilltops are going to take up most of the 50% open space in a lot of those tracks. I mean, again, I think this can be built out well. I think I would love to spend more time. I don't want to spend more time on this. but I do think that this is a complex puzzle. And yes, we're going to pay for it over time. We're going to pay for failing traffic over time. So there's no option. I don't know if this option still has failing traffic. Does the traffic models fail on this one too?
We didn't do a model per se on this one, but
I bet it does.
It would be between probably somewhere around the flyover and option 3 would be my guess.
Which was the existing approved traffic already shows failure at our interchange, so we're just adding to that.
Existing approved already shows. I mean, you know what? You'll pay $100 million over time. We'll finance it for you over 20 years, and it'll still be failing.
Yeah.
I think this can be built out, and I think we can do it smart. I just struggle with it.
What's the side distance for interchange TDOT requires?
Or to have another one, how far?
Well, there's no, between Paytonsville Road or Goose Creek Bypass and the interchange, it's not enough room at all. So they wouldn't approve anyone, and they wouldn't approve one within that distance there. I don't know exactly what that is.
2840 and Goose Creek, there's not enough room there.
Because if you go too far north, you're impacting Goose Creek. If you're too far south, you're impacting 840. There's a lot of runway you need to get people on and off an interstate like
but
that.
It's like you mentioned downtown Nashville, where you have Broadway Church. Oh, I mean, that's not a fair example, given the 2 miles of distance you have between Goose Creek and 840. You sure we couldn't petition that and get a interchange?
It can be done. It's just an approval from the feds and the state that they have to sign off on it. We will continue to have those conversations and keep asking.
Yes, sir.
There's a certain point. We keep getting no's.
But I agree with you. I like the plan. I think you need to move forward with it. I don't, you know, the hillside ordinance plays a big role over there, and how sacred is that to the extent that, you know, Ramsey built that giant auditorium on top of a big hill. Was that not in a hillside protection?
I believe that was approved prior to the creation of that ordinance.
You know, so it can, is there some leeway with that? There's a lot of land down through there with some residential use, you know, along those slopes that could be built. Is there not a vehicle or not an exception to the, you know, that hillside for that particular area?
We're applying the standards that we apply citywide to this area. And we, over the last, earlier this year, we did get updated contour data and aerial imagery and slope contours. And we ran a slope analysis, and we put that on the project webpage, so anybody can go on there and look at the slopes. But there are some pretty steep slopes.
Yeah.
There might be a few areas that are, you know, maybe questionable, but I think most of the areas, it's pretty steep.
But then that kind of brings in the density question, and is a PUD allowed in that area? Is some 3-4-story units allowed in that area? You gotta have enough density out there to pay for all that infrastructure.
Right.
But we need this road. We need it to cross. We need to move on with it and see if we can petition the state to get that interchange. Full access.
Well, I think I go back to the short, mid, and long, and we think the shorter term areas has, you know, some possibilities to kind of get going with private dollars and minimal city dollars, but that's a conversation that will probably come back to the board at some point. But the rest of the basin sort of depends upon getting the Paytonsville Road improved, getting Carruthers extended, and getting Goose Creek Bypass extended in those short-term areas to kind of pull the infrastructure out.
I got one more question. I know when the study was done, it didn't factor in June Lakes interchange, and as far as being a little further south from alleviation of traffic or not, there's a little broader range of that traffic study change the level of services?
Likely not. Once you get a certain distance away, the distribution gets so muddy in the water, so to speak, that it's hard to accurately predict where vehicles are going to go and come from. So we took ours down to 840, and that's where we stopped.
Okay. Thank you. Great job.
Could you tell us where, or send us, not tell us now, but send us the thing where you said, you know, earlier this year you got new info and everything.
Yes, ma'am.
Just send us the link to that. That would be convenient for
yes, ma'am.
Not only for here, but for some other places to look at.
Alderman Peterson, you asked about Long Lane. We budgeted $22.3 million for that project overpass.
How much do you think it's going to cost now, though?
I plead the fifth. Not sure.
Yes.
Is that the current price for the project, or is that what was originally budgeted?
That's what's budgeted in our maps here. I'd have to get back to you on the cost now. It's probably higher than as we imagine.
Okay. Anyone else?
My computer died, so I'm not sure what I've got here. But there, in any of these, I see it said small scale office. So there's not any plans for a large scale office in that area, are there?
Not that I'm aware of.
No. Okay. It's good. Yeah. I'm with Patrick, though. Everybody, I think number four is our only option, really.
And just to reiterate what you were saying a moment ago, is it was a staff's direction to not have large headquarters additionally in this area as well, correct?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
But there's going to be a really big one, real close.
Last call. Did you get all you needed from us on this topic tonight?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right. That was it. Conceptual workshop.